Good evening, everyone. Welcome to ITVA at the Bali. My name is Shirin Seda. I am a programmer here for cinema. Tonight we have a very special program. We have a double bill with the topic The Truth and the Powerful. That means two back-to-back films. And we're starting with Bellingcat, Truth and a Post-Truth World. So I'm going to say a few words about the program tonight. We will start with Abdulrahman Hassan, who is a digital methods researcher, and he will give a short introduction. Then we will watch the film, and directly after the film there is a panel discussion. My colleague Tim Wagemakers will enter into a conversation with the director Hans Pohl and Bellingcat member Nick Waters. It's going to be an awesome panel discussion, but if you need to leave before the panel discussion, I would kindly ask you to do so silently during the titles at the end of the film. There will also be time for questions from the audience during the panel discussion. And that works as follows. You will raise your hand, and then Tim will walk to you with a microphone, and then you can ask your question. And the trick, really, with questions is that they're always short, and they end with a question mark. Keep that in mind. yes, so I wish you a very nice evening, and a warm applause for Abdulrahman Hassan.
All right. Good evening, everyone. Before we kind of start the movie, I wanted to do a little interrogation of the kind of themes that are about to arise in the movie. And the movie has in it post-truth world. And that term is naturally quite charged. So what does post-truth mean? What do we say? Like, what does this term hide? And I want to do a little interrogation of even the power dynamics of this term hides. So one thing we know about post-truth is that in 2016, it was chosen as the Oxford Word of the Year. So it's at the top of its hype curve. We live in a world, a time almost defined by this word. And the Oxford definition for it is that the objective truth, the objective facts, are no longer taking the forefront as your source of reliability, but rather personal belief, emotion, agenda. But I want to also dive deeper, because this is all a trend, it's a buzzword. I want to look beyond that buzzword. What does it mean? Is it only specific to this time that we've been post-truth, that we've been championing agendas over objective truth, for example? And if you look at the kind of Google trend search, which is a very basic metric of the popularity of the term, you can see that there's a spike of post-truth in 2011, one in 2016, but can we really consider it as a signifier of the time where we live? And if it isn't, then why is it at the forefront suddenly again? So I don't want to... There's a lot we can discuss about previous occurrences of post-truth or imaginaries of post-truth, but maybe in the past century there's been a lot of writers who have discussed like settings where truth no longer prevails and it's more agenda. So like George Orwell's 1984, Hannah Arendt, T.S. Eliot, they all had concepts that were quite groundbreaking that have only detailed the same kind of historical moment that we are living now. So it's quite an old concept. And it's not only relevant to the field of news or new media. I also argue that it's even a more fundamental discussion about the subject and object divide and about modernity, because the whole premise of being modern is that you as a modern citizen can separate objective fact from your emotions, from your biases. And this, over the past few decades, has been also a clash between the sciences and the humanities. And this clash we can see in the SoCal hoax, which happened in the 1990s, where a French philosopher, quantum physicist, published a paper which was a hoax at the end, without saying it's a hoax, in a journal, and the journal published it without it being fact-checked. It was a humanities journal. And this has always been a signifier of the blurring lines between being objective and being subjective. So the whole idea of that there being an objective truth and then the fact after it, a post-truth, has been consistently been challenged. So what does this mean? How does this relate to, let's say, Bellingcat, the movie you're about to see, new media, fake news, all these other buzzwords that we have been experiencing? So I think what is really specific to our time, not the fact that we are in a post-truth world, but more that we have an excess of data. Data that is being generated everywhere exponentially grows. So we produce data every day. The moment we walk on the street, the CCTV takes data from us. There is more data than we can process, that even some theorists would call this era the end of theory, that you no longer have to build models to predict things, but you have the full data set of everything you need. But at the same time, we don't trust how that data is being used. We don't trust my relationship. Data, it's no longer a self-standing fact within itself. There is a step after that. We know there is a step after that. We don't know. It's kind of that whole object-subject divide. So data becomes a weapon for something. It becomes a tool for something. It enters this whole realm of power relations that you, as a consumer of the media, but also a producer of the media through the, you know, the new social media, the web 2.0, you become a producer of this data. But at the same time, you have to interact with the new media platforms like Facebook, Twitter, all these platforms that we interact with day to day. They facilitate you to become a consumer producer. But also something that we forget is that new media also clashes with old media, traditional media. And the amount of time spent by the general public on old media is almost always, like across the globe, more than new media. So it still holds a lot of power. But then also legislation and international politics goes for people to push the certain narratives that they want to push, the stories that they want to push with the data. So data enters this whole new power field. What I want to discuss more is the consumer-producer a new media relationship, because this part is actually the signifier of our time. The fact that we can produce media, the fact that there is algorithms that arrange the data for us. And this is quite nice, because we can all produce our own data, we can all push our own stories. So the field for investigative journalism, of kind of taking the lead and pushing the narratives we want, opens, and this is Bellingcat becomes possible. But this is a diagram that was kind of made by the Public Data Lab here in Amsterdam. And you see all these are circles representing news stories that are fake. So like in the top right, there's a story about RuPaul being harassed by Donald Trump in the 1990s. And the orange circles are the false information and how many people they reached. And the green circles, which you can almost not see, is the grassroots fact-checking campaigns and how many people they've reached. So that's how many people have known that, have gotten the information that RuPaul was harassed by Donald Trump, and that's how many people have actually got the correction. So what I'm trying to say is that just having the Internet 2.0 and the whole paradigm of investigative journalism is just not enough to cause a disruption, to find the truth, because there is no truth. The lines have been blurred. And I want to say two stories to illustrate this. The first story comes from kind of almost personal context, is the 2011 revolution in Egypt, which was dubbed the Facebook revolution. And it was almost one of the biggest breakthrough moments in investigative journalism, as in there's so many people in the grassroots checking the government, surveying the surveyor, the surveiller, sorry, what can happen? But at the end, the use of all these investigative journalists or citizen journalists was not tactical. They did not understand the relation to the other power relations that I discussed earlier with the algorithm, how the algorithm can be used to push certain narratives or not. They couldn't take control of the old media. And most of the efforts of citizen journalists were reversed. And it does not exist in Egypt anymore, the whole field of citizen journalism. The other one kind of dismisses the fact that if you do citizen journalism, it's always for good. It's always a liberal notion. It's always you're going to find the truth and everything's going to work out. So actually, citizen journalism has been done by the alt-right even before 2016. There's a book which details many stories about just trolls, internet trolls, that have been doing some of the hardcore investigative journalism work. One story actually happened in 2016 of Shia LaBeouf, who wanted to make this art project about just "He Will Not Divide Us," as soon as Trump was not elected, a flag being live streamed on the internet, and it had to stay for the duration of the Trump presidency. What happened is that there are trolls on a social media platform that is anonymous, inhibited, that fuels alt-right politics called 4chan, have made it their mission to find out where this is, where this flag is, through flight data, going above it to triangulate that data, find it on the ground, send someone to drive around the neighborhood, honk, and find this and replace it with a Trump hat. So this kind of politics, this kind of investigative journalism has been really glorified by the rise of the new internet paradigms that everyone gets the same power online, but there is algorithms shaping the way that which information is passed around. There are old media that you still have to be tactical about, and I think this is something that Bellingcat does very well. When do we make the bridge between new media and old media? How do we orchestrate our attempts at pushing new stories? You're not finding a single truth anymore because, as we illustrated, the lines have been blurred. So this comes with a few warning signs. So when you see the movie, there's a few warnings that you have to check. First of all, that if you're fact-checking, it's not inherently a good thing. It's not inherently a thing that is innocent, objective, or liberal. You have to say, who am I doing this for? What is my position, let's say, as an Arab man in this society in relation to that data? Because if I get raw data, I don't trust it. How does it serve me in my position in that society? Because also, I think the last point, which I want to end with, is something that also relates to the movie, that we're not just uncovering truth for the sake of uncovering truth, but we are being tactical about the way we push certain narratives, and that notions of justice, transparency, and kind of being aware of my tactics in bringing new information to the world is kind of the most important thing. And yeah, thank you so much.
So now that the people obviously are running to another film of ITVA, we are very welcome, and we're very happy that Hans Pohl is here, the director of the film. Give him a warm welcome. You can sit there and please take... And there's also some water next to you. We're also joined by Nick Waters. Nick Waters is working for Bellingcat. He's an ex-army officer, and he's done, for example, some work for Bellingcat on the use of drones in Islamic State, so we can hear all about your work a bit later. We're going to talk for 10, 15 minutes, and then I'll open the floor to you to ask your question. So already think about that one thing you want to know, because we have time, I think, for 3-4 questions. So make it a precise, concise question about what you really need to know, and otherwise you can't sleep tonight. So that's your goal, to make sure that that question is being asked. But first of all, Hans, I'm very happy that you're here. I think you've made an absolutely thrilling movie, which I read on the internet. People say sometimes when you look at it, it feels like a spy thriller. There's so much going on with the work of Bellingcat. Maybe just to start it off, when did this story of Bellingcat start for you?
Well, it was 2 years ago. I think I read an article about the Bellingcat member, and he discovered the place of the launching of the missile who hit the MH17. And I was reading the article, and I thought by myself, my God, this is just a civilian, just a house father. So what's going on? And then I started to think about making a film, because he was not the only house father. There were several house fathers working on really big things. So I started to think about making a film about it.
And then you got in touch with Elliot, I guess?
Yeah, this was because I got in contact with the Dutch member, and then he got me in contact with Elliot. Yeah.
And that's what got us to where we are right
to
now.
To the others, yeah.
The film is about, I think, one of the most interesting things about the film is that people try to grasp what is Bellingcat, you know? Is it journalism? Is it trying to get people accountable? You've been talking to so many people about this. You've been talking with so many Bellingcat people. If you already said no, so I get a hint of your answer.
No, I don't think so.
But what is Bellingcat, according to you?
Well, they are citizens, and they are researching things. But a journalist is writing an article with background, etc. But this is really, I think, it's a little bit. It's different.
Yeah. And does it matter? Because it's used by
no, it's the, I think the way they are working and the results are very, very important.
Yeah. What's the most? You started this film with some ideas in your head. You've read about this investigation. What's the thing that struck you most in the sense that I got an idea of where I wanted to go, but then this
with
happened.
The film,
yes.
No. No, I just started, and for me it was so, when I started, it was just five or six house father behind a computer screen. So for me that was the starting point, and that was so a boring for a filmmaker.
Yes.
So I decided to do everything to make it.
Because in the end, it's
exciting.
Just people behind laptops. You know, if you strip it down to the bone, and you had to make a movie about it.
Yeah. But the
which
things
could give
they
some
are
headaches, maybe.
Investigating.
Yeah.
That's I really concentrated on the investigation of the guys.
Maybe it's also good then to introduce Nick. Nick, you are working for Bellingcat. Maybe just to start the same question, when did Bellingcat come into your life? When did you start working with them?
So I was at KCL doing a master's in conflict security and development, and one of the modules I was doing was open source intelligence. Ironically, Christian Trubert was actually on my same course as well as Alim Leroy, who also works at Bellingcat. And I just asked if my final piece of work for that module could be published on Bellingcat, and Elliot agreed to. And then since then, I've been publishing and then helping out with workshops. And now, as of a few months ago, I'm fully employed by them.
You're fully employed now, yeah.
Yeah.
And can you tell us something about what you're working on right now? What are you doing?
Yeah, I can a little bit. So right now, there are two things I'm looking at. One is a disinformation campaign against a group of civil defense workers. So over the last kind of 3 or 4 months, mainly from Russian sources, has continually associated them with chemical attacks. Mm. But they provided absolutely no evidence whatsoever. And if you take each one of those accusations by itself, it's very difficult to refute because there's no evidence to debunk. But when you take them as a data set, so 22 different accusations, you can start to bring out some of the absurdities within that argument. And then the other one's about a series of drone attacks that have been happening on a Russian
base. The drone attacks,
Syria.
So, you watched the film. Do you think it's an accurate account of what Bellingcat is doing? What did you think when you saw the film?
Well, when I heard about the film, I the same kind of impression, like, how are you going to make a film about a load of us, like, sitting behind laptops and, like, like staying late till, like, 4 a.m., like, looking at videos from Syria? And what you've done is actually really impressive. Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah. The thing that there are many things in the film that are interesting to talk about, but one thing stuck with me, and that is the authority of Bellingcat compared to other institutions. I think Jay Rosen says it, is trust, and transparency gains that trust. So if you're transparent, you get the trust. But the thing about trust is you can spend so many hours building it, it's gone within seconds if you do something, if you do something wrong or you mess up. How do you see in your work for the film that they do this transparency in an ethical way that they could have built this trust? Because some people say, well, it's about collecting those data and everyone can do it. But when I see the reports, it's so interesting, but it's also mind-boggling. I mean, I read it and then I think, okay, I understand what you're doing, but it's difficult. And still, people trust it. Is there an explanation for that?
That's, I think, very difficult because I'm a filmmaker, you know. So, for example, the story of Eric, you know, with fuel prices, etc.
Yeah.
I think maybe it's. I don't know how long it will take to discover all those things. Maybe a month or maybe more. You know, I really don't know. So in the film, it's just about 4 or 5 minutes. But then it's coming really kind of magic, you know.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, those guys are working for nights on it.
Yeah.
So.
And you get many reactions because this night's called Speaking Truth to Power. Well, you can see by the way RT portrays Bellingcat that they are a bunch of, I think he says something like armchair or armchair activist or something like that. What does it say to you, those reactions? I mean, you're I think, belling the cat in the sense that you get a response that you got. Is it part of the job or is it something deeper, and does it say something deeper about your work and what you're doing?
What, their reaction?
Yeah.
I think it shows that you've got a group of people who, until a few months ago, you know, you had like one person employed full-time and the others working part-time, and it's affecting government narratives, whether that be Russian airstrikes in Syria showing that they're not actually hitting Islamic State targets when they said they were, or whether that be showing that the US has bombed a mosque when it says it hasn't bombed a mosque.
Yeah.
And the fact that we're having that kind of effect on the debate, I find incredible.
Yeah.
A lot of work we do, you never get any feedback from it. I've done some work on Yemen, and it's quite frustrating that when it doesn't get picked up in the same way that our other work does. But when you do get that kind of reaction, that's a real, you really feel like you've like achieved something.
What's your goal? Because when you hear the people in the film, people from Bellingcat say different things. Huh? They have all different. That there is this one guy who works in Syria, and he says it was activism, civil rights. I want to expose it. There's someone else who's saying I want accountability. There's someone else saying I want. What's your goal working for Bellingcat?
So I think my time in the army awakened a latent distrust in authority that I didn't necessarily understand I had or understood I had. So for me, it's very much kind of like holding people who lie to account, especially governments, and being able to do that or being in a position to do that is both thrilling and also quite scary sometimes.
Yeah, scary because?
Because what if I'm wrong?
Yeah, well, it comes back to the introduction, I think, that's being held by our first speaker who said, the thing is that you also have a responsibility. It's also the guy from the investigations team says you have to be really sure before. Is that how do you deal with that? Because you can say Bellingcat has many response, but you can also say Bellingcat takes a lot of burden on their shoulders by being so if you say it negatively, but I'm not meaning it negatively, arrogant to say we know the truth.
So I think that comes down to a methodology. When we post our investigations online, if anyone has read them, you'll understand, but we take the reader by the hand and we guide them through the same evidence that we've seen. So we show them that, you know, this video is from this location, this image is from this date. This testimony does bear up to scrutiny when you look at sources like Google Earth or whatever other reference image you want to use. And being able to show people our working, and all that information is online, our collection is mostly passive, is very, very powerful, because only in very rare cases do we actually have to ask people, look, trust us, or trust this anonymous source that you've never heard of.
Yeah, and you hope that built on your work, at that moment they will say, yes, we do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hans, where do you see the story of Bellingcat? Because I can imagine for a filmmaker it was difficult to stop filming because there are so many new developments going on with Bellingcat. Where do you see the story and the work of Bellingcat go in the next years? As in, is there an overarching risk in the work they're doing that's becoming more manifest? I mean, you've spoken to all these people and also their worries maybe about their work.
Oh, yeah, sure. But and what's your question? What's the risk? Or
it's twofold. How do you see Bellingcat develop in the next years? Because the people you spoke to, there are many people who say they feel a void, but at the same time, there's a big reaction.
Well, I think the professional journalists will take over more and more that kind of the Bellingcat method. Yeah, I think.
Yes. Yeah.
But that's a big result.
Yeah. And is there also, and then I want to go to the audience, a risk you see for the coming years for Bellingcat?
Well, I think so. The Russian government, I don't think, that are also Russian as citizens. They live in England, but I don't, it's really hard to believe that Putin is gonna kill one of the Bellingcat members of Elliot. Or
I think Timmy really said they can kill me, but the work will go on, so it's not useful, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's not. But it's so really painful to think about that.
Yeah. Nick, what's the biggest risk for Bellingcat according to you? Because there's also the money to be able to do this work, for example. What's worrying you? And actually, the mirror of that question is, how can we support Bellingcat? What's needed to be able to continue this work?
So there are kind of two risks I see. The first is the, getting a bit academic, like the dislocation of society, especially with... Dislocation of society, especially when you talk about like social media and how people are reduced to their own echo chambers, their own spheres of information, and they find it increasingly difficult to break out of it. And as much as we can do to publish reports or to raise awareness of issues, if people don't want to read our reports because they live in their own echo chamber, they're never going to read our reports or find out these facts. The second part is when we take this and we take open source and we try and hold people to account in a legal setting, there's a great opportunity there in that we can take so much of this information. Like Syria has some of the most well-recorded war crimes ever in history. And we want to be able to take that to court and say, look, this is evidence. And we need to do that right, because if we mess it up, then...
it can't be used.
Yeah, precisely. Yeah.
Are there any questions in the audience? Someone says, I want to. Yes, I come to you.
Oh, you had to fast. I saw a kind of a documentary yesterday on the television. And my question is, how you keep up with technology? Because your technology can be used by others, and technology develops. So when do you know what is true and what is not true? I mean, it's wonderful work what you are doing, but how much time will you keep up?
So I don't know if you ever heard of the phrase, there's no such thing as a good fake. A lot of the time we investigate stuff, and every source buttresses, or every thing that we use as buttresses, the other thing. So it's all consistent. So we'll look at the satellite imagery, witness statements, images, videos from the event itself. And we usually find it's pretty easy to, or not easy, but like you can work out the facts of the case using that evidence. And it's a wide range of different things. So we're not just taking like one video which can be faked by one person saying something. We're looking at a wide variety of different evidence to identify what has actually happened.
I think I saw the documentary also, and it was indeed about deep fake videos. You know, you have Obama saying stuff that he doesn't say, and you say we can still check that if it's fake or not.
With deepfakes, just taken individually, it'd be kind of difficult to work out. But when you bring into the context angle, you know, like Obama wouldn't say those things. And then you could go deeper and you could say, okay, where was he when he made them? He was at a press conference. Okay, who else was at the press conference? There are always ways you can check it.
Here's a question.
Yes. Are you prepared for a possible scenario that the internet itself is not an open source anymore?
I think that'd be something that'd be very difficult to prepare for. It's something I do worry about. So having seen so much of the public sphere and civil society interact on the internet, you know, you had the Arab Spring and people engaging using social media to do so. But it's actually an incredibly fragile public sphere. You know, Saudi Arabia has built its internet infrastructure in such a way that they can shut it off with the flick of a switch because it will go through the same cable, same route. And that is something that does worry me, because I don't think either we or indeed the rest of civil society really understand quite how fragile this new public space is.
Does it also have to do with where you look? Because, for example, if you look at China, it might be more difficult to do this open source. So that also works into a kind of bias in the work that you can do and that you can investigate?
Yeah, so one thing that I am also quite concerned about is this, the kind of focus that you have on the evidence that's available, on availability bias. So for example, everyone knows about our work in Syria and Ukraine because there's a lot of open source media there, but there's not very much of this kind of investigation going on in, say, the DRC, because internet penetration in Syria is about 23%, 33%. Internet penetration in DRC is about 6%. So you'll see a focus on the data that is available.
In the back, yeah. And then we have time for one more question, and yeah, okay, then I come to you.
Hi, I was wondering, when you go through all these social media profiles and all these things, elaborate investigations, do you have any issues about privacy, any ethical issues?
Yes, we do. We try to limit the information that is require, or like, if there is information that could put someone in physical danger, we will try our best to censor it or to make it difficult to find. So for example, with the 53rd Brigade report, we censored a lot of the names and the faces of the more junior soldiers because we didn't think they had enough agency in order to justify revealing who they were. But all the things we find are open on the internet anyway. Anyone can find it if they choose to do so. It's just a case of us making sure that if we point to something in the internet, that we are very confident about it and we have a reason for revealing it.
Do you have guidelines for that, in the sense that a newspaper has a manifesto or statutory guidelines that says we don't do this, we don't do that? Or is it up to the, well, discussion you have at that moment?
We have quite a few, like, quite vigorous discussions within our chat channels about it, but we don't have any firm rules.
So the investigation method is quite a scheme, and then the transparency is the other. Take out the transparency for now. If you think about companies, well, not companies, institutions like CIA, Mossad, GRU, where are they using, as far as your knowledge tells you, the same research method, or have they adopted accordingly today?
I can only guess, not guess, educated guess at this point, but I believe they have, and they do. And they've been using, like, open source is a tool that has been used for decades and decades since the Cold War. And I certainly believe that they use the same kind of principles of geolocation that we use. I mean, you had Iran using a... there's a very good article a few weeks ago came out. It showed Iran had taken down a CIA spy ring because they knew exactly how to search for it in Google. They identified the domains, and then they identified the IP addresses that were going to those domains. So behind the IP address, they find CIA agents. And that was all open source. So yes, certainly they are, the same techniques are being used by nation states. Yeah.
Hans Pohl, maybe to end with you, because in the end you made this amazing documentary. What's the thing, according to you, because you've been having many Q&As already about this film, you talked to many people, the main idea that we could take away with us when watching this movie? I mean, everyone has their own idea, but of course, you're no exception to that.
maybe for me it was very important to see that just ordinary people can really do something very, very important. That's it.
And will you follow them for the coming years? Maybe sequel? Bellingcat, post-truth in a post-truth.
I just finished this one, so.
Yeah. We ask again in a year, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. I want to thank you so much for being here, Hans Pohl, Nick Waters, and also the introduction by Adel Rahman Hassan. For those who are coming to the second movie, we will open again at 9 o'clock, I think, the hall. So you can maybe, if you run, get a quick beer or a wine and come back. Then I hope to see you. Thank you so much.
Days to feel each other, crack their spine.